this experience gave birth to what I understand to be the deepest feminist conviction for both of them. And that's the understanding that only a movement run by women can go the full length of the way. So it's that point, as Stanton says, with great sort of sadness in her words, that we gave up the counsels of men forever and knew we could only rely on ourselves to win these rights. So it's that point at which the women's rights movement becomes a women's movement.
So there was a tremendous hunger for what was called normalcy. And normalcy meant getting back to a very private life in which external things like a falling economy or a war didn't impinge. And a lot of this fell on women to create this kind of life. And I think women were very eager to undertake a new modern role that this domestic emphasis reflected. And yet, I think at some level, many of these women understood that there had been other options that were closed to them. The majority of articles in popular magazines were about how fabulous the new world of women was, but there were other articles in which the idea that women maybe should do something with their education.
I think there was the sense that women needed more, and this sense of like, is this it?
Why are you alone here?
It's the middle of the day.
It's lousy.
You know, why do I feel this kind of emptiness? Why am I sort of depressed or anxious when it seems like I should be one of the happiest people on the planet?
And they thought something was wrong with them. This is also the period in which psychiatry is becoming more and more popular. It's also very male.
Invisible.
The whole idea that a woman who wanted something else was sick, there was something wrong with her,
you know,
was feminism. It was a name that had existed, that people in the 20s and 30s and 40s had used. And by the post-war period, it was either not used or used as a term of disdain. So I think Friedan's point was to give a name to this problem, and by naming it, to begin to open up the possibility of addressing it and changing it.
The
publicity of the civil rights movement, the model of fighting against discrimination, the very word that we use, the name that we give, we use the name sexism to name that problem, was a word that didn't exist in this period. And when it was invented in the late 60s, it was a deliberate imitation of racism. There's racism and then there's sexism. The civil rights movement begins to raise questions of economic discrimination and inequality. So does the women's movement.
You wanted to see me?
Close the door.
These were women who were pretty identified with their labor force participation. They also began to raise the issue of the disparity between men's and women's pay and jobs as a kind of discrimination.
I think especially in this period, as the culture as a whole and people individually were moving away from religion, the question of how to live with death, with the knowledge of death, and the loss of the dead, was one of the biggest challenges, one of the things that kept people attached to their religions. And spiritualism addresses that. For the most part, free love is the conviction that the state should not at all, it's a kind of anarchism, that the state should not be involved in the affairs of the heart. And so what this means is the law should not regulate what they would have called true marriage. Let us say the profession of reform was an honorable one in this period, and one that apparently, that obviously Victoria Woodhull aspired to participate in. I think Victoria was extremely ambitious. She wasn't sure what direction she was going to make her mark in history on. I mean, one of the charming things about her life is that she sort of brings together all these things that we come to think of in history comes to make opposites. She is a Wall Street broker, and she's the first person to publish the Communist Manifesto in the United States. There are people with big ideas who want their ideas to make an impact on the world, and they are uneducated in the way they're supposed to be. They are not from the conventional middle class. And this is a real offense on the part of the larger society. Now, we have to remember that this is the period in which Congress is, it's just written three major constitutional amendments. Congress is really in control of the government at this point. And the 15th Amendment has just been ratified about a year and a half previous to this, a 15th Amendment constitutionally giving black men the vote.
The argument is basically that by the 14th Amendment, women are citizens of the United States. The 14th Amendment says all persons born or naturalized in the United States are citizens thereof. That's the first part of the argument. And the second part of the argument is that being a citizen means voting. It's a pretty simple, straightforward argument. When the Supreme Court finally tackles this argument, which they do in 1874, they say, you're half right and you're half wrong. Women are citizens of the United States under the 14th Amendment, and being a citizen doesn't give you the right to vote. So the suffragists' strategy was related but different. Instead of asking for a congressional declaration of intent, they wanted to go up through the courts, and they wanted to have the Supreme Court rule on their construction of the Constitution. And ultimately, the Supreme Court did rule on their construction of the Constitution, but ruled against it.
There's another argument that she makes, which seems to me to be really show that it's really her mark. It's a really interesting argument. She not only argues that the 14th Amendment authorizes women to vote because it nationalizes citizenship, she argues that the 13th Amendment is relevant to women. Now, the 13th Amendment does one thing and one thing only. It abolishes slavery. And she argues that marriage is a form of slavery. It's a very interesting argument. And I cannot imagine Ben Butler making that argument. That's a woman's argument. That's a radical feminist argument. What was the name of the game of Victorian morality? The name of the game was, what you said was more important than what you did. It was more important to keep what was said consistent than to measure what was said against what was done. My sense is when you read 19th century stuff, you can't really understand. Their languages for talking about intimacy, affection, and sexuality is so different than ours that we cannot really understand exactly what goes on. Here's a good example. People will say, he made love to me in the 19th century. So-and-so made love to me. That doesn't mean that they have sex. It means that they come and court you.
Probably.
She thought that he had the possibility of being on her side because she knew him to be a personally passionate man, but I think there was never a possibility that he would be honest and that he would be in public what he was in private. I do think it's important to say that although there was a kind of larger agreement that marital rape, involuntary motherhood had to be spoken about, that Victoria Woodhull and most of the other people on the women's rights platform, including Isabella Beecher Hooker, ultimately meant to take that critique in very different directions. Most women's rights spokeswomen wanted to cleanse marriage of its sexual coercions and its inequalities. Victoria wanted what she said. She wanted to do away with marriage entirely. I consider her a great warrior against hypocrisy. And I think she did too. I think she, at one point she said, Beecher's crime is not his adulterous affair with Elizabeth Tilton. His crime is hypocrisy.
Beecher.
Victoria was arrested in 1872 as I think the second person arrested under what was called the Comstock Law. The Comstock Law was a law passed in 1872, a federal law making it a federal crime to use the United States mails for obscene purposes. This is an extremely important law in American history. This is the exact same law that Margaret Sanger is arrested on under 44 years later. You know, 15 years after the worst of the scandal, after the smoke is cleared, after Victoria sort of put herself back together again, both Isabella Beecher Hooker and Elizabeth Stanton resume contact with her and treat her like a comrade, like a sister.